Good day, poker peeps. This is Sky with Smart Poker Study, and in today's video, I'm going to help you turn preflop calls into three bets. So the first question is, why would we want to do that? Well, three betting is aggressive poker, and as we all know, aggressive poker is winning poker. Now, I've seen this play out through hundreds of database reviews, not only of myself, but all of my students as well. When we're three betting, we're making more money on average per hand or per 100 hands than we do when we're calling the two bets. Speaking of two bets, why is calling preflop bad, being that first two bet caller? What message are you sending when you make the call? Well, first off, you're telling everybody that you're just down for hopeful poker. You want to see the flop. You're hoping you hit a pair or some kind of a good draw before you continue on and put too much more money into the pot. Also, when you call, you can't win the pot right now. You're planning on seeing the flop, so you might be able to win it, but it's going to come some time later on. Also, when you call, you just automatically show weakness. Your range is less than your opponent's range. They raised, they have aces and kings. You just called, you probably don't have those hands. Also, when you call, you entice others to three bet squeeze. And I'm sure this has happened to you a billion times. You call, somebody three bets, and oh, dang it, I'm just not getting the right price. My hand's just not good enough. I gotta fold. And now you just gave up those calling chips way too easily, right? Also, when you call, it often leads to multi-way pots. And as you know, multi-way pots are more difficult to win, either with bluffs or to get value out of your opponents both ways. And also, when you're the caller, you're gonna be the one facing c-bets. So let's look at the other side of the coin. Why is three betting good? Well, the reason why is opposite of all of this stuff, right? When you're the three better, you're not playing hopeful poker. You're taking your poker life into your own hands. You're sticking it back in your opponent's face with aggression, making them make the decision whether or not to continue in the hand. And because you're doing that, you can win the pot right now. You three bet, everybody folds, bam, you just took down 4.5, 3.5, whatever, however many big blinds are in the pot already. You're not showing weakness when you three bet. You have aces and kings in your range. If they just call your three bet, they probably don't have those hands. You've got that stronger range. And when you're three betting, you take away everybody else's good three bet bluffing or three bet squeezing opportunity. Now, it does not lead to multi-way pots. Most of the time, three-bet pots are heads up, which are a bit easier to play. And of course, you're not going to be facing c-bets when you're the three-better. You're going to be making the c-bets, putting that additional pressure on your opponents. Alrighty, so to help you three-bet more, I'm going to discuss the six elements of the perfect three-bet bluff. First off, you're in position against your opponent. So they raised wherever, EP, MP, cutoff, and you're on the button. You're in the cutoff. You're in the MP. You have position against them. Next up, you hold an ace, preferably a suited and or a connected ace right there to give you a little bit more options post-flop, a little bit better chance of hitting something on the flop in case you get called. The third thing, you want to face a small open raise and your opponent still has a large stack. Now, this is kind of a key idea because if you three bet to 9 big blinds and they call, if they started the hand with just 40 big blinds, well, that pot on the flop is already roughly 20 and their stack is only 30, right? You need that post-flop maneuverability just in case they call to give you the options of bluffing them post-flop. You also want to see that their raise first in by position is greater than 20%. Now, this holds true whether you're a live or an online player. Greater than 20% just means they are raising a ton of hands, oftentimes in the cutoff and button for most players, but occasionally in the MP and those loose aggressive maniacs under the gun as well, right? But you want to look for a player who has a really wide range. It's going to make it more likely that they're going to fold versus your three bet. Next up, you want to look at their raise and then fold to three bet percentage being greater than 50%. I mean, the higher, the better. If somebody raises and folds 80% of the time, holy cow, that's lovely. You want to three bet bluff that person, right? But if they fold less than that, 10, 20% of the time, you've got to really expect a call. And then that's why it's also good that their fold to flop C bet is greater than 50%. The higher, the better, of course, but greater than 50 just means they give up relatively easily on the flop. So here's the thing. These are the six things that make for the perfect three bet bluff. If all of these are in place, you're making a huge mistake by not three bet bluffing. So we've got a few, eight different hands lined out here. Some of these hands I three bet, some of these hands, which are kind of similar to the prior hand, are where I called. And we're gonna analyze each of these real quick to see which of these elements are in place for my three betting and for my calling. So we're gonna go through these relatively quickly. So 2.2 big blinds, and I come in with a three bet. Loving the fact that I three bet. Obviously, I am in position, so let's put a big X right there. I do hold an ace. It is connected. It's a gapper, two gapper, right? But it's not suited, so it's not the best. Like, even better would be ace-jack suited right here. But this meets the requirements of an ace and connected. Small open raise and a large stack. Look at that, 2.2 big blind open raise. 240 big blinds behind. We have 114. So much maneuverability post-flop in case he ends up calling. Raise first in by position is greater than 20%. Well, his raise first in is 25% as a total, but if we pop this open right here, his raise first in the cutoff is 20%. So we're good, he meets that category. Raise and then fold to three bet greater than 50. Well, we've got 64% here. And then fold to flop C-bet, well, 61%, we got it all. This is a mandatory three bet bluff right now. And the reason why I say three bet bluff is, yeah, ace jack could be ahead if he calls me with ace 10, ace four, king queen. I'm ahead of him currently, but ultimately I would just prefer to take this pot down right now, right? If he does call, I got that backup plan of C-betting, double barreling, maybe even triple barreling. He folds 86% of the time on the river. But ultimately, I'm just happy right now taking this pot down and earning the 3.7 big blinds and not even having to see a flop. Ace three suited right now, three big blinds, and I come in and I just call. Remember, some of these hands are where I just called instead of three bet, and a fold and another call right there. So let's look at the three betting opportunity first. I am in position, that's good. I do hold a suited ace and connected. Small open raise, not really small. That's just like an average three big blind. And look at that. He's got a big stack. I'm sorry, a short stack, I mean to say. Now, the thing about this is actually a really critical thing because you're three bet bluffing your opponent. You don't have the strongest hand in the world, and you really want them to fold. In case they do not fold, well, you want them to have a big stack. So like I said before, you have that post-flop maneuverability. Let's imagine I made it nine big blinds. Fold, fold, and a call. There would be 19 and a half big blinds in the pot, and he would only have 37 behind. I mean, he's committed with any pair, most draws, and given that he's a loose aggressive player, such a short stack, he's not folding if he connects with any kind of flop. And if I don't connect with it, the only way I can win is to bluff him. If he's not folding to a bluff, yeah, it's not a good three bet bluffing opportunity. So we don't have that large stack in place. Raise first in by position, guaranteed it's greater than 20. Raise and fold, well, we haven't seen any three bets yet. And fold to flop C-bet, we haven't seen him face C-bets. So with only three out of the six and not a large stack, I'm fine with this call. I could have three bet had I chosen to, but I'm fine with making the call here. One of the things, remember how when you call, you show weakness and you entice others to three bet squeeze. We don't have aggressive three betters over here, so that's less of a consideration. So that's something to think about before you end up calling. You want to look for high three bet of like 10, 17, 20% right here, right? Queen 8-9, yeah, I just give up. I'm just folding or checking the whole time. He finally bets, and then we give up right there. Never know what he had, if my three bet would have worked or not, but I'm fine with a call in that instance. Now the 6-5 suited, let's see the action, got a raise. Now before I three bet, let's go over this. I am in position. I don't hold a suited ace. He does have a large stack and so do I. It's not a small bet, but at least it's not 3.5 or a four big blind open. His raise first in, he's a 41-33 player with a raise first in at 26. Yeah, guaranteed in the MP, he's raising at least 20% of the time. 0% fold, 0% fold to, or fold to three bet, 0% fold to C bet. So those aren't in place, but I love the fact that I made this three bet right here. Sometimes you just got to put players to the test. Very loose aggressive player, probably has a really wide range, and I just did it and took that one down. Let's look at a similar hand, 7-6 suited now. We get a raise, a small raise, and then I decide to just call. Well, let's take a look at this. What elements are in place? I'm in position, of course. I do not hold an ace. It's a small raise, but look at, once again, a small stack. If I made it nine, It'd be roughly 20 big blinds in the pot, and that he'd be down to 40 something. If he hits any part of it with only a stack to pot ratio of 2, he's committed. Hard for me to get him to fold with that 7-6 suited. Not impossible, but hard, right? Race first in by a position, greater than 20, guaranteed. When he's in the cutoff, he's probably got a 35% range, maybe even 40, 45%, right? Raise and then fold to 3-bet, he's at 100%. It's a small sample, but yeah, it's greater than 50. Things are looking good right now. But he doesn't like to fold on that flop. So for me, because I've only got 3, when you have 3 of the 6 elements in place, you've really got to consider it, especially when it's not a large stack, because like I said, that takes away your maneuverability. So I'm fine with a call. I would have been fine with a 3-bet too, just putting him to the test, right? He might have just folded like that prior player did. Now, think about this. Ace high board. If I had 3-bet, they would have probably folded. And there's a good chance he would have called, right? Or, I mean, folded or called. He folds 100% of the time. But if he had called, when you 3-bet somebody, they're often going to just put you on ace, king, ace, queen. He might have called with pocket eights. He might have called with 7-6 suited. He might have called with king, queen suited. If he doesn't have a good strong heart or a flush draw or anything, on that ace high board, he's going to check to me. I'm going to c-bet. He's going to put me on ace, king, and bam, he's going to fold. Really easy opportunity to pick up the pot as the c-better in a 3-bet pot on an ace high board right here. But because I didn't, I'm just playing this kind of straightforward, and he makes a bet, and I check. Or I fold because I have nothing whatsoever, right? Let's see what happens at the end, see if we see his hand. Jack 7. Called after I called, and then the pocket eights, and then the jack seven ended up taking it down. I bet you on that flop with his eights, I would have gotten him to fold if I had 3-bet pre-flop against him. Let's take a look at a queen jack suited hand. So what elements are in place? And I did make the 3-bet here. I'm in position. Don't hold an ace, but look at that. Small bet, large stack. I've got a full stack as well. Loving this. Raise first in by position, guaranteed it's greater than 20 when he's in the MP. I know it's it looks like, you know, he's under the gun. Well, he is under the gun right here, but because we're missing a player, he's in the MP. Let's actually take a look real quick. Oh, 30%, good. Now raise and then fold. Well, it's not there and not there either, but I think everything is in place with that tiny little 2.3 big blinds. I think this is a great spot to be 3-betting. He calls right there. 6-8 deuce. Got the 2 overs plus the flush draw. He checks. Now, it's not the wettest board in the world. And the great thing is I block him from having ace, queen, king, jack, king, queen of diamonds. Things that could easily continue. So I bet, and he folds. Take that puppy down. My 3-bet preflop led to me making a simple c-bet. And he just gave up on it. Lovely little pot to take down. Now, the king, queen offsuit. We got a small raise from a big stack villain. 2.2. I just call right here. So let's take a look. I am in position. I don't hold an ace. Small bet, large stack. So that's in place. Raise first in by position. Let's take a look. He is actually technically, because these players are missing, he's in the cutoff right now. Weird. It's only 7%. That is really weird. It's 1 out of 14. So maybe he does have kind of a tight range, and maybe that's why I decided to just call right here. But generally, a player like this, 26-19, maybe he just hasn't been dealt many hands in the cutoff worthy of open raising. So in general, like I said, that player type is capable of raising plenty in the cutoff. And maybe he doesn't see this as the cutoff. Maybe with these players missing, he's thinking this is like an EP spot or something. I don't know what's going through his head. Nothing here, nothing here. So because there's only 3 things going for me in this hand, I'm kind of fine with making this call. And we don't have aggressive 3-betters behind us right here. Oh, if I would have 3-bet preflop and then c-bet on that flop, I could have taken that bad boy down. And actually, I should have bet right here. Kind of a hard to hit board, ace high. If he doesn't have an ace and he doesn't have an ace, I guarantee they're both folding if I bet. So I missed a good bluffing opportunity. Yep, yep. Let's take a look at the 7, second to last hand. 3 big blinds, nice. So what do we got going for us here? In position, of course. Not a suited ace. Decent 3 big blind raise, just kind of standard, but he has a full stack. Raise first in by position. Oh, it's only 14 hands. That's not necessarily in place, but he is in a steal spot. There's a good chance he is raising that often in the cutoff. Raise in the fold to 3-bet. We don't see it. Fold to c-bet. We haven't seen it down here. But sometimes you just got to make that 3-bet to start developing a 3-betting history on your opponent. Now, an interesting thing. You could see at this table, I've been here for 59 hands. I'm a tight aggressive player, 3-betting at 12%. I only have 14 hands on this player. There's a good chance my 3-bet at 12%, he didn't see a single one. This could be the very first 3-bet he's seeing coming from me. He's going to give me loads of credit right here. Now, I could have just called and tried to set mine on the flop. We've got an aggressive play over here. Like I said, my call could lead to his 3-bet squeeze, which I'd probably just have to fold to. So I like really taking charge in this hand, even though I got 3 things going for me out of the 6. Because it's not listed here, but image could be like a 7th thing. If you have a tight image, which I possibly do, like I said, only 14 hands, I like this 3-bet. And I take it down. Let's look at the last hand right here. Raise all folds, and then I decide to just call. Let's take a look at what we got going on. I'm in position. I don't hold an ace. Small raise, large stack. Nice. Raise first in, it's 31% as a total. 35-24 loose aggressive player, probably. He folds a ton. He folds to c-bets a ton as well. Holy cow, we got 5 out of the 6. This right here is a mandatory 3-bet. And I'm just kind of disappointed in myself that I didn't make the 3-bet here. And then look at this. We got a 55-25 in position, capable of 3-betting. And what does he do? He 3-bets, and then I just fold right there. I'm not going to compete with a player who 3-bets really big like that as a squeeze, right? Just not worth it. So, man, I made a really bad call right here as opposed to a 3-bet. So one final message for you. So if all 6 of these items are in place, it's a mandatory 3-bet bluff. And I think if all 5, it's a mandatory 3-bet bluff as well, unless this is the one thing that's not in place. If he's starting with a 30 or 40 big blind stack, I can understand not 3-bet bluffing somebody. Now, if it's 4 or 3, as you saw, we got a lot of 3s, nothing with 4 elements in place, you got to consider it, right? If it seems like it's a better play than calling, make the 3-bet. And then if 2 or less, probably not. Skip the 3-bet bluff. Just call or just fold and exit the hand entirely instead. Watch the action. See what his open raise ends up being if you get to showdown. Now, a critical idea. Hit their pain threshold at 9 to 10 big blinds. You saw all of my 3-bets were at 9 to 10. This player made it at 10.3. Guaranteed that hits everybody's pain threshold. If he would have made it just a measly 7 big blinds, I bet he would have called after open raising, only having to call 4.8 more. And then I probably would have called as well just to set mine with those really good implied odds. Now, here's the thing. For a lot of people who have a hard time 3-betting, I highly recommend that you do this because you're in position. You're doing it from the cutoff and the button quite often. But as you do it more and more, you gain success from it and you start enjoying your 3-betting, start experimenting with 3-bet bluffing from the blinds as well. Especially when these 5 items are all in place right here when you're in the small blind or the big blind. All right, thank you so much for watching the video. I hope you take action and start to at least try turning some of your calls into 3-bet bluffs when you're in the best positions. If you enjoyed this video, subscribe to the channel down below, please, and give it a thumbs up. And I'll catch you next time.